Undetected Footprints, we're talking about Heather Turner. She died on Thursday, May 4th of 2017 in Dallas, Georgia. Heather's husband, Andy Turner, stated he found his wife shot inside the couple's bathroom at their home on Buck Trail in Dallas, Georgia. The sheriff's office is still trying to determine whether Heather Turner died by taking herself out or was it a homicide. The only other known adult in the home that day was Turner's husband, a pastor in the community. Andy Turner, Heather's husband, heard a noise around 5:30 in the morning and found his wife dead in the bathroom with a single gunshot wound to the head. Though it was described as an apparent self-inflicted gunshot wound, Heather's death not yet ruled that she took herself out. The couple's 8-year-old daughter was also in the home. Andy Turner has not been listed as an official suspect in Heather's death, but his immediate actions were called into question. Was the time lapse from when he heard the gunshot to when he called 911? Turner initially claimed to have discovered his wife at 5:30 a.m., yet did not make a call to 911 until 6 a.m. Heather's death remains under investigation. Andy is now being accused of physical abuse and sexual assault, including the R word, by his former nanny and girlfriend, a 27-year-old Christy Choop. It has yet to be determined which way Heather was killed. Here is 11 Alive News speaking about Heather's case. Let's watch.
May 4th, 2017. This typically quiet Dallas neighborhood is about to be jolted awake.
Listen, what are you calling to report?
Wife shot herself.
The caller is Andy Turner. Here he is with his wife, Heather, the mother of their daughter, Lexi, a woman full of personality. Heather's aunt, Cindy Clark.
Oh, she was majestic. She was so charming and so full of joy, and I know everybody says she lit up a room, but just her sense of humor and her kindness was outstanding.
A stark difference to the sinister act alleged to have happened inside the couple's Buck Trail home, where their 8-year-old daughter at the time was asleep.
Andy, did you find her like this? Do you know how long ago this happened?
I was in the bedroom. And I heard the noise.
You heard it?
The coroner's report shows Heather was found on her back in the floor of the couple's bathroom. Andy Turner's 911 call alleges he found her in the shower. The 911 call lasted 14 minutes. It included not just Andy, but we heard his mom and dad, who briefly spoke with the dispatcher, putting them on scene before first responders. The calls would continue.
Andy called me that morning and told me that Heather had killed herself.
Any indication she was ready to take her life?
None. None whatsoever. She would not have done that with her daughter feet away from her in the next room.
The Paulding County Coroner's report describes the scene. In it, she pointed out a wall near the toilet had appeared to be washed. The report also showed a note was left.
It says, "I'm sorry, I love you."
Yes, I believe Heather wrote that note, and I believe it was stuck on something small long before she passed away. Heather was a note writer. She wrote songs. She was very wordy, and she expressed her heart. So why now would you not leave a note? If you're such a writer and if you express yourself so thoroughly, why wouldn't Heather leave a note for her daughter?
The coroner requested the GBI medical examiner take Heather's body. 5 years later, her death is still classified as undetermined.
I just want answers, and I want the truth, and I want the case to be closed.
I reached out to Andy Turner, but he refused to talk to me. The Paulding County Sheriff's Office confirmed the case is still open. Andy Turner has not been named a suspect in his wife's death. Sergeant Ashley Henson with the Paulding County Sheriff's Office says Andy has not been ruled out as a suspect either. In fact, Sergeant Henson says Andy has refused to come in for a formal interview.
If it's suicide, call it suicide. and let's close the case and everyone get on with their lives. Show me that evidence or prove that it was suicide, and I'm okay with that.
Heather's aunt just hopes one day.
I can't not think about it. I can't forget about it. It just won't go away. I think of her all the time.
The truth will prevail.
I fight for Heather and think of Heather every hour of every day.
Up next on The Talk with Connie, she is speaking to Andy and his two kids. Let's take a look.
With me is Andy Turner of Paulding County. Andy is here along with members of his family to talk about the story behind his new book, Who Turned Up the Silence? This is the first time the Turners have spoken publicly about what happened on the morning of May 4th, 2017. So family is really important to you, right, Andy?
Oh, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
My family's the most important thing for me. It always has been. That's the way I was raised.
Yeah.
And the only way this story could be told is for the entire family to tell it. This is my daughter, Lexi. This is my oldest son, Austin. I do have two boys that are also authors in the book that are not here. Well, the majority of my focus right now has been working on this book.
Mm-hmm.
and being dad. I've been dealing with some sickness. So with that and being able to do this has been the majority of my time.
So it's been 6 years.
After Heather died, we started restoring cars. Therapy for us.
Mm-hmm. Andy, your story, your book, the story in your book, does not begin with your wife Heather's death. Let's start with the night before it happened. Were there any red flags that evening? Any signs that something might be wrong or different?
Not at all. One thing about Heather, there was never a time where she was not happy.
Mm-hmm.
Anytime she walked into a room, she lit it up. She had a personality that was much bigger than her.
Mm-hmm.
And for a long time after her death, with the education that I have, I questioned myself on, there had to be a red flag. There had to be something. And I failed my wife because I didn't see it. I missed something. And I've gone back and I've asked myself that question many times. But there was nothing that I ever caught, nothing I ever saw, because she was always so happy and everything was perfect. And I would have told you up until the detective started bringing me information that we had a perfect marriage. It was a postcard. And I was extremely happy and loving my wife and the family. As we were content. And on that last night that we had, the chapter in the book is titled If I'd Only Known.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember her writing me, said, "Hey, baby, I have the text messages that will be in the very last chapter of the book. It's nothing but our text messages for the last month."
Mm-hmm.
And she said, I want to cook your favorite meal. And she asked what we had. And, man, I was excited because Heather could cook. And the whole plan was for her to come in and fix the dinner. And if I had only known, that night would have been different.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you hear people say, well, don't the family deserve to know what happened? Well, mm-hmm. the family knows exactly what happened.
Yeah.
You know, there's no doubt. We know. We have the information.
Mm-hmm.
The other people out there, they claim that they have the facts, don't, and we address that in the books and what it is. But that last day, the day that we had together, was a fantastic day. I had salmon and biscuit mm-hmm. and gravy and cantaloupe, and she had a little chef that mm-hmm. helped her prepare it. You want to tell that story?
She came home and she was really, like, really excited to cook for him. And she got into the kitchen and I wanted to help. So I started helping her and we rolled out the dough and did all the salmon patties.
Mm-hmm.
And we brought it to the table and we sat down with Dad and she fixed him his plate because she always fixed him his plate. That was her thing.
She was a nurturer.
She liked it. And we ate. We enjoyed it. We enjoyed our meal.
And Lexi, you would have been 8 at this time?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So after the meal,
yeah.
What?
I got up and I started putting the dishes in the sink, and she jumped on my back. And being silly, which was very common in her house, so we have a very playful household, and always have. And when she jumped on my back, I just started prancing around the island in the kitchen and was giving her a ride and was being loud and silly and went around the kitchen. And then in our house is very long. So I went all the way into the dining room and down into the living room and turned. And when I looked up, she's standing there and she's filming and taking photos of her parents, mm-hmm. of her parents loving each other mm-hmm. and having fun.
Sure.
And it was a great night. And when I come back up and, you know, she's acting like she's a cowgirl, you know, yeah, yeah. And I'm like, look, I'm not a very good horse. I got a bad back. You're breaking it. But, you know, if I'd only known, I would have rode a little bit longer. Mm-hmm. You know, I'd have a few more laps.
Sure.
But it kept going. When you think back, and you know, hindsight's 20/20, and you know that you're about to lose your best friend and mm-hmm. and your wife and the love of your life, you know, those aches and pains don't quite mean as much.
Yeah.
But that night was a beautiful night, and when it was over, we sat down and she'd fixed a glass of wine, and then Lexi wanted to do some pottery because she's a little artist. and we sat and watched her on her little potter's wheel, and she made art. And I remember Heather saying, look at this little monster we created. she's over there making a mess. It was a fun night.
Mm-hmm.
And she created that night to be perfect. Yeah, you know, and I've thought back on how meticulous she was on making the night so mm-hmm. perfect.
With your meal and then the family interaction and everything like
yeah.
that.
Yeah, and we sat down and watched TV, and Lexi fell asleep on the couch. We was watching TV in the living room. She didn't normally sleep there. And once she fell asleep, we decided just to let her rest and not pick her up and carry her upstairs. Mm-hmm. We went into our bedroom, and then, you know, that part of it, she continued. You know, she made sure that our time, you know, mm-hmm. husband and wife time was special.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, if I'd only known, she did. Mm-hmm. You know, she knew what the plan was. But to me, I was just thinking, I'm the luckiest husband in the world. You know, I've got this beautiful family, these great kids, this wonderful, beautiful wife, and what a great life I have. Mm-hmm. And I'm just soaking this up like a sponge. And I had no idea that life was about to change, and change in the most god-awful of ways.
Austin, yeah. You were not home that night. It was just the three of you. But do you have any thoughts?
I think people don't understand that she took preparation to make this decision. And we didn't have preparation to deal with the decision that she was going to make. She knew that she was going to make something rash.
Mm-hmm.
She allowed them to have a great night, but he lost a wife. We lost a mom. And people don't care to understand that. People don't think about how it affected us.
The next morning, can you tell us what happened?
Yeah. I'd fell asleep in the wee morning hours. The last thing I remember before was that she'd pull my hand up on hers like this, and she took a photo on her phone of us holding hands. And I was laying on her back, and then I fell asleep.
Mm-hmm.
I'm on the far side of the bed. And I'm awoken abruptly with a noise. You know, when you first wake up, you don't have all of your senses.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So I wake up, I hear a noise, and I think, you know, what was that? And I realize she's not there. And we have a stack in our shower, one of those spring things that's got shampoo and everything on it. And I thought, well, maybe she's failing. She's not that over. I take off around the bed, and I'm going to go make sure she's all right. And when I do, Lexi had got up from the couch, and she's running, and we meet at the bathroom door at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
And I push the door open, and we're both going in. And then I realized the noise that I heard was not the following of the shampoo and the stuff, because the way the bathroom was, there's a sink and a counter, and I can see over, and I see the top part of Heather's body. You share what you saw.
Walked in and I just saw the bottom part of her legs on the ground.
Mm-hmm. We're going to share some more. When we return, we'll listen to the 911 call.
What happened after your dad and you met at the door? You went in, you saw what you saw, and then what?
He grabbed me and we fell back and he's crying. So he picks me up and he takes me to the couch and he says, "Don't move. Mommy's hurt, don't move." So then he starts doing all his phone calls and people start coming.
That's right.
So, Andy, there has been some speculation about why you, or what you should have done, especially in regards to your decision to call your parents before calling 911. Can you walk me through the process of what happened at that point, that morning?
Absolutely. First, nobody knows what they're going to do until you're there. Mm-hmm. Until you see somebody you love in that position, you have no idea what you're going to do. On that particular morning, once I had identified what had happened, and I didn't want Lexi to go around that corner and see her mother in that full condition. Mm-hmm. She had already seen enough. And when I fell back in the floor and I'm holding her, I'm trying to hold it together. Mm-hmm. And I pick her up and I take her to the couch and I set her on the couch and I was like, "Do not get off this couch," because I was afraid when I was in there with Heather that she would come back in there. So I said, "Do not move." So the first thing was I wanted to get my daughter taken care of because she's not hurt. And I don't want her to be hurt and damaged anymore by what she's already seen. So I called my parents and I said, "Mom." My mom answered the phone. I said, "I need you to get here right now." Heather shot herself. Mm. "I need you to get here as quick as you can. Lexi's on the couch." And then I immediately called 911. From when I talked to the detectives, that entire delay was a minute and I think it was 18 seconds.
And your family lived very close by.
They did. They're only like just a few miles down the road. Mm-hmm. I go in, I call 911. And I'm now beside Heather. Mm-hmm. And I'm doing everything that I can to try to save her.
At that point, did you still think there was some hope?
I never gave up hope. Sure. But when I was, you know, looking at, I mean, I realized there was probably not much.
Yeah.
But I wasn't going to not try.
Right.
And I don't remember the 911 call. I don't remember it at all. I've gone back and heard it. And when I hear it, I know that's my voice. And then I've learned what I said by hearing it. And then I hear myself even saying, "I'm going to keep trying. I'm going to keep trying. Heather, wake up. Why did you do this?"
It has been said that at some point during the 911 call, you whispered the words, "I killed her," to your mom. I want to hear your response to these allegations, but first, I think we should play part of that 911 call.
Located in the house, Andy.
We're in a bedroom with our shower's just getting
She's in the bathroom?
Yeah, we're in the bathroom.
Okay, just keep doing
it. Turn the shower off.
You're turning the shower off?
I can hear you.
Okay, all right. Andy, let's keep doing compressions, okay? Hard and fast, about 100 times a minute. At least 2 inches, okay? Take a deep breath for me, Andy.
Oh, my God.
Andy, take a deep breath, okay? You still want to keep doing compressions? Andy.
This is Mother.
Okay. Is Andy still there?
Did you say "I killed her" to your mom?
Absolutely not. And not only is it extremely clear that I didn't, do you know who else knows that I didn't say that? Well,
who?
The FBI's went through this, the GBI, the Secret Service, and the Sheriff's Department with all of their equipment.
Sure.
They've evaluated this with their experts. And if I had said that, you know where I wouldn't be sitting right now?
Right here.
Right here. When the experts go through and they examine it and they find nothing, but people on hate sites, that's what they hear. Well, of course, that's exactly what they hear, but that's not what's said. If you listen to the 911 tape, you can hear that it's splotchy, and my phone in the bathroom had awful reception, and it's cutting in and out.
And you weren't being still, I'm sure.
Oh, no, I'm doing active CPR on my wife. I'm still trying to save her. And my mom came in. The best thing that I can remember saying was, "Mom, I could not save her." And that's what they want to turn into, "Mom, I killed her." Oh, you know how many phone calls the Sheriff's Department was getting per day from these websites? Hundreds.
Wow. So after the 911 call and the authorities get there, I believe I've read that no one took gun residue from your hands, all kinds of things like that. What actually happened?
Before I left that bedroom, as soon as I left Heather and exited the bathroom into my bedroom, there was a wall of cops in a semicircle that I walked into that held my hands and immediately took gun residue. Immediately showed nothing. Or again, I wouldn't be sitting here.
Sure. And then what?
And then for about 5 hours that day, I sat through questioning.
So it is, would you say that it is a false allegation that Andy Turner has not been questioned by the police?
It's extremely false. And, they have photos of me naked.
Because they checked your body for...
If I would have, any defensive wound, anything. If I'd have been fighting. They made me stand there right after I had just saw my wife in that condition and get completely naked.
Yeah.
And turn around and take photos of me.
Yeah.
That was very difficult. While I'm still looking at my wife and my best friend laying there.
And wondering what happened. How did this happen, right?
Yeah, but not just that, but the things that they would say and how smart ass that they were to me. And then one guy said, "Well, if we didn't get anything, check them again and go deeper. There's got to be something on there."
Yep.
And here I am, upset. And immediately, the moment that I walk out after this loss, I'm already enduring this from the Sheriff's Department. And then for 5 hours, I go through questioning. But when they left, Lieutenant Christopher said, "This is a clear case of suicide.
Okay. It's
open and shut, and we're done. I give you my sincere condolences."
And where is Lexi at this time? With your mother and father?
She had been moving around to different places, but they were... about to move the body. They'd taken photos and photos of the bathroom and me and the entire house, but we didn't want her to see her mom be carried out. So she went upstairs, and I know the medical examiner was up there, Lindsay Eberhardt, and my mom, because we didn't want her to witness that.
Sure. So, Lexi, I'm just going to ask you this question. Do you have any doubt in your mind that what your dad is saying and what you're remembering is inaccurate?
Everything he's saying is completely true. There's not anything that's wrong. There's not anything that's tampered with. It is all factual.
And you were there.
Yes, ma'am, I was.
You guys, not just emotionally and as a family, have been through so much, but people are putting you through extra trauma. Honestly, am I correct?
Oh, yes. 100% correct.
And so a lot of things have happened. Do you want to share, Austin? Do you want to share something that's happened to your family since then?
Absolutely. The first day that it happened, we didn't even get hours after the incident. And people at my school, people that I don't know from the public, already knew things that happened that morning before I did. People had the 911 tape, and they were pushing it around social media. I had people texting me that I hadn't talked to in years. Asking if I would answer questions that they had.
Just kids?
Kids. But we would go out in public and try to live some normalcy. Mm-hmm. We'd go to lunch, to the store, and people from all walks of life would walk out of nowhere and decide that they were experts on our lives. Mm-hmm. They were experts on
the case.
What happened mm-hmm. in our house. Mm-hmm. Like they knew us. So that was a constant battle. We couldn't eat in peace. We couldn't shop in peace.
So, Lexi, what have you been through?
A lot of bullying from DFACs. They have had almost, 120 calls in one day. I've had them showing up at my school, questioning me, asking me if my dad's ever abused me, molested me, not fed me. And I kept telling them over and over that none of that happened. But they kept coming like day after day after day to the point where I had to change schools. Mm. They have hurt my dad, which that hurts me. I don't like seeing him hurt. Mm-hmm. That hurts the whole family because we are all one unit. We work together. And when one person is broken, the whole family is. So just seeing everybody else sad and hurting is the worst thing in the world. Mm-hmm. It adds further.
The defects that she's referring to was awful because people would use the system to bully and abuse us. Mm-hmm. When you're getting 120 calls a day, and let me explain, when we found out where they were coming from, these were other states. People that never met any of us. And the folks on the website were putting these things out and private messaging people, and they were calling defects reading a script. Mm-hmm. And so we sat in and talked to the workers, and they were asked, do you know this person? And the majority of them would be anonymous callers. Mm-hmm. But when the calls come in, they still have to investigate.
Sure.
So they kept going to the school, and I'm like, well, you should come talk to me. Yeah. They kept going to the school, and they kept pulling her out of class. Well, Heather's cousin was the principal there. Mm-hmm. And so now I'm being kind of ostracized at this, and they're singling out my daughter. Well, I had a lot of problem with that. And they kept singling her out, and I go pick her up from school, and she's getting in the car, and she's like, Dad, the police are back today, and they're asking me this. And I'm like, seriously? And it just wouldn't quit. So then when that didn't get what they wanted, then they would move to the court system and the sheriff's department. And then people are getting hundreds of calls a day, and it's funneling through all these social media accounts, and people think that they're doing good, that they're saving the kids, and the kids are... And I'm sure that some of those people thought that they were doing well because they believe what somebody told them. But they had no idea the harm that they were doing and the hell they were putting our family through.
Sure.
And how bad that it became when we're waking up in the morning and murders rode across our garage door. And I think we're up to, 45 cut tires.
Wow.
Cars keyed. And people that we've gone out with being put in harm's way. Death threats. I've had to hire security to follow my children and needed it mm-hmm. on multiple occasions.
Sure.
And they've had to step in.
So you probably always feel like you're being watched and being judged.
We were.
Yes. And does this still go on today?
Yes.
Yes.
Lexi, there was a time one Christmas. Can you tell us about the golf cart incident?
We were on the golf cart riding in the neighborhood because that is our tradition. We go around and we look at Christmas lights every year. Mm-hmm. So we were riding around the neighborhood and we were in this one cul-de-sac and we were turning around and there were a lot of people. They had been drinking, obviously. But we turned around and we were going out and Bubba was on a different golf cart. And this one lady made a comment. She said, "Isn't that the murderer?" And me and Dad and Kelly were riding and we heard his tire squeal. Mm-hmm. So we look back and we stop the cart and he's getting out and he's walking towards his people. And there's a lot of people screaming and a lot of people yelling. And this woman is like profusely apologizing because he's upset. Like he doesn't want people calling him any names that are not true. Mm-hmm. So he gets out and he's trying to diffuse the situation, trying to calm it down. And there's this man, he's yelling it, he's all in Austin's face, and he's like, "You need to roll on." And a lot of people start walking out of their homes. And there was this one woman, and I was standing back because I didn't want to get involved in the big ruckus. So I'm standing there, and this woman in her driveway says, "He murdered his wife." And I was like, "Are you serious?" And she looks at me and she goes, "You need to watch cable TV." And I'm like, "I was there. I know what happened."
Now, Austin, can you tell us why you're here today and why it's important to you to be part of the process?
It's not just my story. Mm-hmm. It's a family story. Mm-hmm. We all went through it together. I was given the choice to be a part of this.
Sure.
And I chose to be. So if anybody is claiming to have any doubts on why I should be here, you shouldn't have put it on us in the first place. We wouldn't have a story if they didn't give us one.
What choice did she have with cops pulling her out and everywhere we go, people coming up and saying anything? Mm-hmm. You know, it's their life.
Yeah.
So now they're speaking out to defend and to set the record straight and to right the lies that's been told for 6 years.
Why haven't you been arrested? Why is this still an open case?
Well, I haven't been arrested because there was no crime committed. But exactly why this thing is open, there's two avenues of that. One, I've been told twice, it's closed. The initial day, this is obviously suicide, open and shut. She left a note.
Mm-hmm. You know, and what did the note say?
The note said, "I'm sorry, I love you."
And Heather was notorious for leaving notes, right?
She left me notes all the time. She mm-hmm. packed my bags anytime I was traveling. She put notes all in my clothes, everywhere. She liked to write notes.
Sure.
But she left that note. I still don't know all what she meant in that, what mm-hmm. What "I'm sorry, I love you" means mm-hmm. when you do something like that. But when you do something like that, you're not thinking with a clear mind, obviously.
Sure.
But why is it open? Great question. I was told directly by the lead detective, Mike Hill, who I've gone back and forth with. We've had some extremely harsh words, that until I do exactly what he wants, it'll be open forever.
And your story on that is in the book.
It is definitely in the book and extremely documented.
Okay.
Why would I do that and then allow them to try to do anything that would later harm me? Mm-hmm. If I had done wrong, there was any evidence of any wrongdoing, they would have arrested me by now. Mm-hmm. But there's not any. So why would I yield to that? Mm-hmm. And number two is they're still getting hammered because you've got boyfriends and family members that don't want to let it die because they don't like the fact Heather committed. Mm-hmm. But you know what? We don't either.
No. I'm here with Kelly Turner. She is married to Andy Turner. And welcome.
Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.
Thank you for being here to share your story. Can you tell me what kind of things you've had to endure as a direct result of the media's attention and focus on your husband?
Immediately after Andy and I started dating, I was bombarded with phone calls, text messages, people reaching out on social media saying my life was in danger. I'm going to be next. Andy is a murderer. I better watch out. And it was terrifying mm-hmm. at first. There are people I have never heard of. They're making threats. They're calling my friends and family. They were contacting people that I had went to high school with that I hadn't spoken to in 10 years.
Wow.
They're reaching out. They contacted my family and said that my life was in danger. My son's life was in danger. Andy's a murderer. I need to get away. They found out where I worked. They called my job. I tried to get me fired numerous times, saying that I was dating a murderer and that no one in the office was safe if I had worked there.
Did you get fired?
No, I did not. Luckily, my bosses are intelligent mm-hmm. and smart and could read through all the malarkey that mm-hmm. is online. Just because you read it online doesn't mean it's fact. So my car tag was illegally ran. Only a police officer can do that. So obviously there is corruption somewhere in that line. My job was also posted because they weren't able to get me fired, so why not put that on there too? I was terrified. Mm-hmm. I had cars that were parked in front of my house that I didn't recognize. Of course, I called Andy in a panic, who told me to call the police, happened numerous amounts of times. I was so scared that I bought a professional alarm system. I added extra lighting, extra locks on my doors, and I bought a dog. I was scared to be at home at night alone with my son. Mm-hmm. I was scared to go to the store. I got hundreds of messages from people that I had never heard of. I couldn't recognize who had sent a message and who hadn't. So if I were to see somebody in the store and they look at me funny or for 1 second too long, I'm immediately on edge. Mm-hmm. It was terrifying. They were calling anyone and everyone, trying to attack me just for dating Andy. Mm-hmm. And I was brokenhearted, because if they were doing that to me, what were they doing to Andy? What were they doing to the kids? Mm-hmm. And the gravity and the turmoil that they cause and are still causing to this day is unfathomable. Really, I cannot wrap my head around how cruel people can be, especially when there's children involved. Mm-hmm. Going after an adult is one thing, but when you bring children into it, it completely changes the dynamic, and it's absolutely disgusting.
So at any time, were you in doubt? At any time, did you think that he might have done this?
Absolutely not.
So what kind of husband is Andy Turner?
Andy is nothing short but amazing. He is romantic. He's loving, loyal, faithful, honest. Even if it's a hard truth, he will tell you. You always know where you stand. He's silly, which I love. Mm-hmm. He's my best friend. All the things that a woman dreams of in a husband is what I have. And I've never felt more appreciated, valued, respected, and loved in my entire life. Mm-hmm.
That's great. That's good. And he's lucky to have you.
Thank you.
It sounds like you're very supportive and loyal and all those things right back.
I'm ready to start a new chapter. Mm-hmm. We, as a family, are ready to start a new chapter. We finally get to break our silence, and it's been too long. Mm-hmm. So I'm very thankful for letting you come here and share a story. I'm excited about the book. I'm excited about what we have next. Mm-hmm. And we're really just excited for peace and to start a new beginning.
Once again, it's called?
Who Turned Up the Silence? Mm-hmm. The way we chose the name was pretty unique. I think anybody who's ever gone through trauma can relate. You know, there's been times that tragic things have happened to you, and there can be noise go around. In this book, there's a lot of things that we're dealing with, you know. And they were given to charities, portions of this back to prevention. We're dealing with being bullied from social media. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of that in here. Corruptness from the court system, you know, and then the stamps on how dads have to deal with just, you know, you going into the court system, just the dad alone is difficult. Mm-hmm. And what it's like when you have an aftermath of tragedy.
Right.
And how to heal. And also, it's a journey of faith. You know, I was raised by a Baptist pastor. Mm-hmm. And my faith is challenged in this. But you'll see that my children, and there's a verse in the Bible that says, if you raise your children in the way they should go, they'll not depart from it.
I think of that verse a lot.
If it would not have been for my children, I wouldn't have been able to turn. And right. So there's a lot that's in this book that you'll see the journey. No matter what walk of life that you come from, this book can speak to you. And we hope that it helps a lot of people. I knew we had a story, mm-hmm. and we wanted to tell it. And there's a lot of facts and a lot of truth in the book that we've not had a chance to tell. But if you read the book, you'll see it. And we've got a lot of documentation for people.
Absolutely. So how can we get this book?
You go to whoturnedupthesilence.com. Or you can go to colorfulcrowpublishing.com, mm-hmm. and there are links to be able to pre-purchase it now. And then soon we're going to be in bookstores nationwide. We're in pre-production for the movie. Mm-hmm. We're pretty excited about that. We'll soon be doing the book tour, multiple states. And then once that's finished, what I hope is for the Turner family is some peace. Mm-hmm.